To cut out a few slides, so it won't go over this time, maybe, but you're not going to get out early, I can just tell you right now. So if you need to leave, though, I understand. Don't feel bad. If you think for sure you're going to leave, please sit in the back. That'd probably be better.
Don't all move at once.
Whoa. Okay. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and get started. This is the class for interpreting lab results. I think this is the fourth or fifth time we've presented at the CUPA conference. And I've been fortunate enough for Ernie Hernandez, who's I'm going to let him introduce himself in a minute, but for him to join me in this teaching this class. My name is Sandy Pence. I'm a supervising environmental health specialist with the County of San Diego CUPA. I've been there about 9 years now. I supervise CUPA inspectors for all the programs except CalARP. We have a specialized person who does CalARP. And then before that, I was a supervisor in Riverside County CUPA. I did inspections for 10 years. I was actually on the emergency response team for about 6 years. And then I was the training coordinator in the Riverside County. And then my family moved to San Diego, so I got the opportunity to be part of San Diego CUPA doing pretty much the same thing. So I got asked to if I wanted to teach at the CUPA conference. So a lot of people seem to enjoy this class. Hopefully you'll enjoy it. If you, they asked me to remind you about your conference evaluation for this class, so any feedback you have would be helpful and to make the class better. And let me let Ernie introduce himself before we get started.
Hey everybody, I'm Ernie Hernandez with LA County Fire. Similar to Sandy, I'm a hazmat specialist, so I do inspections. Prior to that, I used to work for federal EPA as a START contractor for about 5 to 6 years, so doing emergency response and cleanups and all types of stuff, getting a lot of experience with laboratory results. And then prior to that, I worked at a TSDF for a couple years where I worked in the lab. I'm actually a chemist by schooling. Don't let that fool you when I start talking. But that's where my experience came from, and part of the reason why Sandy asked me to help. So.
All right. Okay, so I wanted to just, before we get started, I want to make sure you kind of have an idea. How many of you have taken this class before? A couple. Okay, cool. And so I just want to make sure for those of you who haven't taken the class before, although Ernie mentioned he does have lab experience, chemist, we've both been doing CUPA for a very long time. So if you're here asking technical questions about laboratory methods, you might, Ernie might be able to answer it, but I don't think I'll be able to. So, but I mean, we could try to take a stab at it, but this isn't the class for you. This is more of a beginner, maybe intermediate, a little bit class for industry representatives who want to find more about hazardous waste determination and interpreting lab results for hazardous waste, and also new CUPA inspectors of trying to figure out how to give facilities guidance and what your role is in interpreting lab results. So just so you get an idea of the scope of the class. They are videotaping, so I'll just let you know about that. And we have a room monitor, Aaron, who is going to have a microphone. So it helps for the videotaping because there may be people who may be watching this course online for training purposes. So if you could raise your hand and then wait for Aaron to come to you with the microphone so that I know we'll try to remember to repeat the question, but it's helpful to hear the question and everybody will benefit from that. All right, so we're going to get started. Okay. Learning why lab results, interpreting them is important. That's what we're going to cover today. Understanding terminology, giving you some tools, and then one of the best ways I learn, it's not a good way, but I learn from when I make a mistake, I usually don't make that same mistake again. So sometimes I do, but usually not. So I hope to share with you some of my experiences. And maybe you won't even make the mistake in the first place. So that's what we're going to cover today. We are going to have some pop quizzes, do some audience interaction. Shout out the answer. It makes it more fun. Don't feel embarrassed. Okay. I don't have any candy. Sorry. All right. Okay. So waste determination. So why do we collect samples? That's what this question is asking you. And here's some of the answers. There's lots of answers why you take samples, but for this class, we're talking about hazardous waste determination. Now, are generators required to test their waste? No. In some cases, maybe, if they're permit by rule, doing on-site treatment, maybe, possibly. But in general, most hazardous waste generators that we regulate are not required to test their waste. And that's something that I think it's important for newer CUPA inspectors to remember. And it's kind of a fine line, because if a hazardous waste generator, a facility doesn't even know what they're generating, sometimes they do need to test it, but we can't enforce that requirement. So in the law, it just says the generator has to make a waste determination. It doesn't say they have to actually test their waste. We also use sampling for investigations and enforcement in the CUPA world. Whenever there's some kind of a release or a violation and we need to prove something is a hazardous waste, we'll collect samples and then get those lab results. Most CUPAs use a contract laboratory and have the samples sent, and they have procedures in place for collecting samples, and then you'll get those results back. And then for remediation oversight. And we don't really talk as much about that in this class, but that is one of the things we do as CUPA inspectors, and sometimes local oversight programs, and you know, depending on your program. All right. So getting back to the role. Now this is kind of a sort of running theme through this whole presentation, because that's one of the biggest mistakes I made as a CUPA. Uh-oh, I didn't use the clicker, did I? Oh, sorry. I think I messed up already. I'll try to remember. Okay. I'm supposed to use this thingy. Okay. All right. So one of my biggest mistakes, because I went along as a new CUPA inspector with a lead inspector, and that lead inspector wrote a facility a violation for not testing their waste. So then I thought, okay, that's what I'm supposed to do. I go to a facility, I give them a violation. You are required to analyze your waste. And then they're like, well, I don't know what tests to run. And I said, okay, well, I got some help. All right, well, you should run totals. You should run this. You should run that. And I tried to give them guidance. And what ended up happening is the facility ended up spending a lot of money doing tests they weren't really required to do. And I found out about this later, through a learning experience. And that wasn't a good thing as a new CUPA inspector. I learned real quick that that's not a good thing to require a facility to spend extra money when they're not supposed to do that. So I just don't want you to make that same mistake. Make sure that when you come across some kind of a waste stream that the facility is generating, or a process or something, and you're not sure about it, ask some questions. Here's a good example. So a machine shop, they have a bead blast machine, and they are doing lots of taking apart of engines and cleaning engines and things like that. So they get all these metal parts and everything out of the engines, and then they put them in this sandblasting unit, and then they clean the metal parts. So then you see all this spent media coming out of this, and you ask them, oh, well, what do you do with all of that? Oh, well, we throw it in the trash. Okay, well, have you ever made a determination on whether it contains heavy metals or, you know, anything like that? Well, no, nobody's ever told me to do that. Okay, well, so then you think to yourself as a CUPA inspector, okay, looks like this could be a violation because they don't know if it's hazardous and they're putting it in the trash, but do you know for sure it's hazardous? No, you don't. Because unless you sample it, right? You're just assuming. So that's where the violation is, not that they didn't test their waste, but the fact that they did not make a hazardous waste determination. So hazardous waste determination is the facility, the hazardous waste generator's responsibility. From that point, okay, so say then they test this bead blast waste. They submit the results to you as the Coupa inspector. Okay, I tested it, here's the results. Tell me if my waste is hazardous. What's wrong with that? Shout louder. It's the generator's job to interpret those lab results. It's not the Coupa inspector's job, right? So, but, you know, sometimes they don't really know what they're looking at. So we have to, as Coupa inspectors, walk that fine line of helping them to know how to make the waste determination, giving them a lot of guidance and information, and then, you know, also looking at the results ourselves to know, okay, is it hazardous? Does this sample show it's hazardous? Was this a valid violation? Do I need to do enforcement because they've been putting in this in the trash, you know, all these years? So, you know, we have to work from our perspective as well. But you don't ever want to write in a report once they give you those results or in an email or in a response, your waste is not hazardous. Because all it was a sample, and you, the Coupa inspector, don't make that determination. So we've talked about the generator's role, we've talked about the Coupa inspector's role, or Unified Program Agency inspector's role. What if the generator really does want to make a determination, I think my waste stream is non-hazardous. I want you to tell me, I'm going to take a bunch of samples of my process waste, and Coupa, I want you to tell me that, I want you to put it in writing that my waste is not hazardous. Is that the Coupa's role? No. So who would do that? It's up here on the right. The state, Department of Toxic Substances Control. An industry can make a submittal and do a bunch of work, and I think they have to pay a lot of money too. And DTSC would then review this waste determination and multiple samples probably, and processes, and maybe there could be a determination that some type of a process waste is not a hazardous waste for that facility. But that can only be DTSC that would make that concurrence. The Coupa doesn't have that authority. And then from the EPA perspective, the federal perspective, we get a lot of our guidance and information. Of course, the hazardous waste laws, we are a RCRA authorized state in California, so we are enforcing RCRA, and there's a lot of good guidance and information on Fed EPA's website, which I'll show you that soon. All right, so we're going to talk more about this, but if you take nothing else away from this class, remember waste determination is the generator's responsibility. So there's all different kinds of samples. There's, of course, representative samples, which is what I talked about earlier. If a generator is wanting to make a non-hazardous waste determination, they may need to take multiple samples at different times of their process, depending on the type of process it is. Another thing that, but usually, if the example I gave earlier where you have this bead blast that's been put in the trash for however many years, you might just be taking a grab sample of that, or maybe more than one. The other thing that comes into play is the source. So in order to know, to be able to determine what kind of analysis you're going to run, or if you're looking at results that actually are telling the true story, you have to know where the waste came from. Have you ever had a complaint, for the Coupa inspectors in the audience, or Coupa representatives, have you ever had a complaint where somebody said, well, I want you to come out and test the soil because I think that there's something that happened here a long time ago. I want you to come test the dirt. Have anybody had that happen? No? A few? Maybe a few. Okay. So it's really difficult because there's a lot of things out there. There's not a one all-in-one test that you would have to run. So you could run, okay, let's say we'll run it for metals. But if that was like something related to pesticides that occurred at that property, if you do an analysis for metals, those results are going to all come back non-detect. Oh, non-detect, it's good, but you didn't test for the right things. So it's really important to know about your source. We'll talk more about that later too. And the correct test method, which is sort of related to what I just said, here's an area where I fall down the stairs in the past, and to continue to, because I'm still learning myself, is there's a lot of exclusions. So everything we say in the Coupa world and related, there's always an exception. Oh, so it's this, but in this case, it's this. So there's always exclusions. And then, of course, errors. You know, that happens with sampling. Sometimes you collect samples, but maybe you didn't you had a contaminated scoop. Maybe that person, used their hand to collect the sample. I mean, I think that's probably unlikely, but maybe the scoop they used was contaminated. There's all kinds of things, and Ernie's going to talk more about that too. All right. Okay, time for the quiz. Are you awake after lunch? All right, what is TCLIP? We're going to use some acronyms in this presentation. I want you guys to know what those acronyms mean. So if you've never seen this acronym, write it on your paper, on your padfolio. Okay? So what's the answer? Shout it out. Okay, I heard one. Two is the answer. Toxicity characteristic leaching procedure is the TCLP, or you'll hear people call it the TCLIP. So you know a cool acronym now, TCLIP. All right. What does STLC stand for? You can shout it out. Three, okay, good. Good, soluble threshold limit concentration. All right, next one. What does WET or wet stand for? Okay, you knew that one faster. Good job. Waste extraction test. And then what does TTLC stand for? One. That's right. Total threshold limit concentration. I have to tell you, every time I teach this class, I have to write down the answer because I forget these things. So I understand if you missed it. Okay, and this is some terms that, if you're about the test methods, you might know what these terms stand for. What's the answer? I heard a three. Very good. Atomic absorption and inductively coupled plasma. So they're machines that are used to check and find out what the concentration of the analyte or substances you're looking for. All right, so here it is. How many have received a lab result? Okay, for how many regulators or Coupa representatives in the audience? Okay, all right, how about industry representatives? Okay, so we have a pretty good mix. All right, and of those industry representatives, how many of you review lab results? Okay, quite a few. All right, so you kind of know why this is scary. Maybe that's why you're here. So the first time I received lab results and was told to review, this is how I felt. I was very overwhelmed, especially when I had the facility, the generator, who I'd given a violation to, give me this big stack and say, okay, here, tell me if it's hazardous. I don't think it is, but here you go. It's like, oh my gosh. So we're going to try to go through this, and Ernie's better at this than me, of going through the laboratory report and explaining what all these terms mean. And we're not going to be able to tell you everything today, but at least be able to get you started. So I'll let him go over that, and we'll talk about that. And we have a laboratory report, and I'll bring that up. But before I do that, the next slide is, if let's just say you get a stack of lab reports tomorrow and you haven't had a chance to look up all this information, one of the most valuable resources I've used over the years is to call a lab technician, the one that actually analyzed the samples. And usually the laboratory manager can help answer some of your questions. And there was a lady, her name is Patty Mata, and she actually taught this class with me a couple of times. I tried to get her to come this time, but she couldn't make it. But she's really helpful. If you want her contact info, you can send me an email. I have some of my cards up here. And she is really good at explaining, like, what is the T-clip? What do you mean by that? You know, what exactly do you do? And have her explain to you what the lab actually does. Okay, so Ernie's going to come up and talk about the lab report. And do you want me to bring up the lab report so you can show it on the screen? Or?
So before we start, there was a handout. Everybody get a copy? Okay. It's just some QC data we're going to talk about. So again, Sandy mentioned the reasons why we sample, why we need data. Again, hazardous waste determinations, enforcement purposes, soil remediation for a few of us. What if ABC Lab does the testing for you and you don't trust them? Okay. Or you sampled it incorrectly, okay? There's QC data that in order to make those determinations or those enforcement issues, you have to make sure your data is defensible, okay? Let me move this up a little bit. So let's talk about some of those QC terms. So when you get the report, you're not sitting there pulling your hair out or having to call Sandy, or email me, or call the lab. Okay, so let's just generic terms. Let's first talk about detection limits, okay? We said AA and ICP were atomic absorption and inductively coupled plasma. Does anybody know what those test for primarily in the hazardous waste realm? Shout it out. What type of analytes are those two instruments looking at? Anybody know? They're looking mainly for metals. Okay, so we're looking heavy metals, CAM 17 or the RECRA 8. We're going to use those two instruments. All right. Now, the instruments are not magic. You can't just inject the sample and they tell you exactly what the concentration is in your sample. You have to calibrate the instrument. You have to set it up prior to even it working. All right. So again, detection limit. Detection limits. Method detection limits, how sensitive is the instrument? So it's talking about the lowest amount it can detect above zero. All right, so let's say you're checking for chromium and your detection limit is, I'm just throwing numbers out there, let's just say it's 0.1. Okay, that's the lowest number that your instrument can see. But that doesn't mean that number can be reproduced or that it's reliable yet. Okay, that's just the lowest your instrument can see, detection limits. Okay, so what the lab does is they introduce a lot of laboratory controls, some standards with known concentrations, and they get a reporting limit, the second bullet point, that tells you the lowest amount that they can see up to a point where it can be reproduced and within certain measures of precision, accuracy, bias, okay? I'll skip ahead and go back to reporting limit. What does non-detect mean? Does anybody know? Does that mean zero? It means the machine did not detect it. Now take a guess. Did they not detect it below the reporting limit or the detection limit? It depends on the method. Some of them, they're the same. For the most part, it's reporting limit, because that's the one that they're confident that there's the lowest they can see. Sometimes the method and the method detection limit and the reporting limit are the same, so therefore it would be the detection limit. But for the most part, it's the reporting limit. So if you get a non-detect, that means it's below the reporting limit. Now there's different names for reporting limit. You might see peak practical quantitation limit. You might see estimated quantitation limit. There's all these acronyms, just like RECRA has all these acronyms. There's all these laboratory acronyms. If you're not sure, again, like Sandy mentioned, call the lab. They'll let you know. As CUPA inspectors, excuse me, when we're writing up our documentation, our reports, our notes, do you say necessarily that something is not hazardous waste because it was non-detect? No. Again, you don't know what the reporting level is. If you're talking about remediation, where the action levels are really low, they might be at the reporting limit. So non-detect doesn't mean that it wasn't there. It just means that the machine didn't see it. So be careful with those, okay? When I am looking for chromium, I'm going to the fourth bullet point now. Again, I set up a calibration curve on my instrument. So I'm setting up the instrument to see a certain range. So again, chromium, let's say I put in a control standard, a known concentration at 1 parts per million, and then another one at 1,000. And I get a concentration calibration curve. All right, if I'm in between that curve, when I put in my sample, I can pretty much attest that my sample's good to go. It's within that calibration range. What if it's outside? Let's say we're talking plating solutions, it's in the percentage range, 10,000 range. How do I get that back down into my calibration curve? Okay, what the lab does is they put in a dilution factor. So prior to even putting it into the instrument, they add in a solvent, whatever the solvent is that they're using to digest the sample, and they bring the concentration down, they analyze it as is, and then when they get the results, they times it back by the dilution factor. So they extrapolation, basically, okay? So if you see dilution factor on your lab report, usually they've done the math for you, so don't times it again. But if you're not certain, ask, all right? So again, dilution factor, it's outside the calibration range, they have to bring it back down, all right? And definitely we'll talk about chain of custody in a second, but if you do have a hot sample, which normally dealing with hazardous waste, they are, right? High pH, high lead, high whatever. Tell the lab that, because they're going to dilute it right off the bat. All right? Okay, again, questions?
Is that dilution factor, is that separate from federal being 20 dilution factor and state being 10?
Great question. You're referring to the T-clip and the STLC.
Yes.
Okay, those are not... Oh, sorry. Can you repeat the question for the camera? Sorry about that.
Does the dilution factor for the lab, is that the same as or different than the dilution factor for the T-clip or the SLTC for the state?
Okay, so Sandy's going to talk about the T-clip and the STLC dilution factors. But yes, it's completely different. Those numbers are based on the laboratory extraction ratios. This is just so that the lab can get their sample down to their calibration curve, all right? Good question, though. Okay, so I've got QC data on my instrument. I know my instrument's working well. Now I gotta make sure I have QC data on the sample, on the matrix. So if I send them a sludgy oil or a solid soil or a liquid plating waste, that all interferes with the instrument. Okay, so I have to set up some more QC procedures. So what the lab does is, again, they'll take a matrix spike. So again, it's a spike is just a laboratory control of a known concentration, and they inject it into your sample. Okay, they take that, and they do it again. They take a matrix spike duplicate. And if you look at your sheet, let's look at page 6 first. What they're going to do, so let's... It's circled matrix spike at the bottom on page 6. Let's just look at antimony, the first one, all right? The spike level, you see that, is 49.5. So they put in 50 parts per million of known antimony solution, all right? They put it into the sample. As a result, you see the result, they got 24.5, okay? If I already put in 49, shouldn't I be getting 49 back? At least, right? If not more, depending on what my sample is telling me. Okay, so right there, again, that shouldn't be up to us to interpret, but they help us out by setting some parameters, all right? So if you look at the percent recovery, the second bullet point, also circled percent REC up top, it says 49, all right? What's the percent recovery limit? Okay, It's 100 plus or minus 25, so 75 to 125. So if I get a percent recovery within that range, my data is okay. But this one says 49, so I'm outside of my range. So again, if I'm trying to make a hazardous waste determination or a legal dumping, and I'm going to take you to court because you're dumping antimony down the drain, but my lab reports, the QC's wrong. Okay, so again, things to really pay attention to. I know as COOPA inspectors and industry, as anybody, to be honest, unless you've got laboratory background, this stuff just kind of goes over your head. All right, we just don't check for this stuff. So whenever it is outside of the ranges, there's always a data qualifier. Do you guys see that M2 to all the way to the right? All right, that M2 is a code. There's a key. I didn't print it out because I don't want to waste paper. But there's a code, and it'll tell you why the data was outside of their limits and what the next step is going to be, whether to reanalyze it or maybe all samples for that day had high antimony. Maybe their control standards were off. There's different reasons. But again, when you see that, call the lab and ask, okay? Okay, there's one more check. Oh, and sorry, the matrix spike and the percent recovery measures the bias of the matrix, okay? The matrix spike duplicate measures the precision of multiple sample measurements. So how precise am I, or is the sample, as I run multiple runs? If I give you five samples, do they match, or how precise am I, okay? And again, similar thing, they're taking like the standard deviation essentially, but only for two samples. It's called the relative percent difference. And they spike it, they put it in, they give you a RPD. So again, let's look at antimony again, it's one. Okay, they have a RPD limit of 20. So if it's over 20, okay, they're not very precise. All right. Does that make sense? Somebody say yeah, make me feel better. Okay, again, certain things to check for, QC data. It's not just the results and that's it. Okay, as an inspector, you should take the full page 1 of 10. You have to read the whole thing. Okay, and as industry, same thing. If I'm requesting data from you, give me the whole package. I don't want just the one page with results on it. All right? Okay. Now, there's also QC involved with field sample collection. Okay? So, I didn't print it out, or we didn't print it out, but online for the COOPA conference, there is a sample reference guide. So if you're checking for metals, you're checking for organics, you're looking for pH, flammability, this is a handy-dandy chart. If you're a COOPA inspector, well, we don't use clipboards anymore, but keep it close, okay? Put it on your phone. It tells you all the following, okay? Certain metals will degrade over time. pH will degrade over time. Sometimes you have to preserve samples, okay? Sometimes certain analytes require certain bottles. Okay, so if you're checking for organics and you have a water sample, you've got to put it in the little 40 VOA vials. Everybody seen those with a little syringe top? Okay, the reason is when they open the sample, excuse me, if you put it in a regular jar, when you open the sample back at the lab, your sample's gone. The sample was in the headspace. As soon as you open the cap, the organics have disappeared. All right, so if you don't use the right preservative, the right container, the lab, your results won't mean anything. So what the VOA vial does is that goes directly into the machine. The syringe punctures right down through it, and you get real data, okay? So again, preservatives could be containers, could be additional chemicals that you add to your sample, okay? There's also holding times. Certain things only last so long. Again, summary's all on this page. There's method and field blanks. So this mainly pertains to when you're using dedicated equipment. Like if we, again, soil remediation type stuff, let's say I have a metal auger. Everybody seen those? Okay, in between samples, I've got to clean it. So it's possible that I'm cross-contaminating samples each time I dig, unless I cleaned it well. So you should take a field blank out, okay? Again, we don't deal with that too much as far as determinations or enforcement, but the remediation definitely, okay, field blanks. And then the last one are duplicates. There's two types of duplicates. There's a lab dupe, okay, and there's also a field dupe. The field dupe, couple reasons. Sometimes as an agency, if we're sending it to a third party outside contractor, I want to check them. So I'm going to blindly send them a duplicate to see how the numbers match up, right? So if my one and two are duplicates and they don't know, I'm kind of sneaky, just testing them to make sure they're doing the right thing. All right, again, just something to think about. And that's more when you've got a various number of samples. You're giving the lab 10, 20 samples. It's not for the quick one or two hazardous waste determination type stuff. Any questions? It's pretty simple stuff. It's essentially all on this chart here. So that's why it's good to have it handy. Chain of custody, same thing. There's a, we didn't print it out, but it is on the Coupa website, okay? Example of chain of custody. I think everybody's somewhat familiar with the chain of custody. This is your legality QC check, okay? It tells you who had the sample, who you gave it to, at what time, they sign it. It's every party until it gets to the laboratory, okay? So for legality's sake, that's totally obviously important. And then what it also does is for the lab is it tells them what to do. So again, if you're checking for metals, you're checking for organics, pH, you're gonna tell them what tests you need. And then in the comments section, you're gonna give them certain hints about the waste. Again, we'll talk about that a little bit later, but is this concentration high? Is it low? Where did I get it from? There's just different, we're gonna go over that in a second. Can you add anything on that?
Thank you. All right, so thank you, Ernie. So, In going a little bit further as far as the laboratory report, just to kind of close up that discussion, although we're going to still be talking about it, but just some more things to keep in mind is when you're reviewing as a Coupa inspector, when you're reviewing a laboratory report, sometimes you'll just find the summary and you don't have all that QA/QC data. You can tell by looking at the page numbers on the laboratory report, it'll say page 1 of 14. And then all you have is like pages 1 and 2. So you might ask, oh, do you have the rest of the lab report? And then usually it's the last page, it depends on the lab, but that's where you find the chain of custody. So you can find out information about the sampler and the time the sample was taken, when it arrived at the lab, and then what exact tests were requested. So that's good information. And then as the generator, having that information available in your files and making sure you keep all of that information together in one place, for example, a waste that you did go through all the work to test it, and it did come back that all the samples you run did show it was below regulatory thresholds, it's really important to keep all of that information as well as the chain of custody and so that you have the integrity of that lab report intact. So something to kind of keep in mind.
How many consultants in the room? Okay, as a consultant, don't give the regulator a summary table in your report. They want the full data, okay?
So in reviewing, and again, reviewing this and making a decision on what test you're gonna be running, and that is something that I've made a mistake on where I'll just say, STLC. And then I'll get a call from Patty, well, Sandy, do you want STLC on all the metals? Because that's going to be expensive. Oh, no, just on lead or, you know. So making sure you give those specific instructions to the lab of exactly what tests you want. And then sometimes if you're broad in your request, And this is coming from the generator's perspective. The lab might make an assumption. So I had another example of where we came across a facility that had been treating their waste and what they felt was not hazardous, and then having it pumped off and hauled as non-hazardous for many, many years. So what was happening is all the wastes from this process were going into this tank and creating this layer of fluoride salts. It was titanium hexafluoride and different types of process waste from a etching metal finishing type facility. So this tank, it was probably about 500 gallons. When you looked at it, it was about half full, because it was kind of opaque, with this solid layer. And the lead inspector, and I was supervising, but she was an expert. She's like, whoa, that's probably got fluoride salts in it, which is hazardous waste in California. So they, we requested, okay, we gave them a violation. You didn't make a proper waste determination. So then they did a bunch of tests, and they did tests for fluoride. Well, they were also do water sample for their permitting of industrial waste discharge. So all of their results came back non-detect. So they're like, no, we don't. There's no fluoride in our waste. It's all non-detect. So we ran a sample, and we requested EPA test method 300, which is what's recommended under EPA SW 846, which I'll talk about that. But it's a big, voluminous chapter on test methods and everything else. So it says right in there for testing for fluoride salts that it's EPA method 300. So that's the test method we ran. And they, of course, exceeded regulatory thresholds. So they disputed our sample results, and I was just like, man, wow, how could this have happened? And I showed it to another supervisor, and he actually noticed. He goes, look, Sandy, they used test method 7240, or I can't remember what number it was, or 1300 or something, and we used a different test method. So then it turned out that lab that they used isn't even certified to run EPA method 300. They don't have the equipment or any of that. So this whole thing came out of, you know, that, and it wasn't really an intentional error, I don't think. I don't think they were trying to, oh, we'll just run it for this method. But it ended up that it kind of sort of put them in a bad place, because then they had to go, oh, okay, well. So it's just an example. Also, reporting units, look at reporting units on your lab report. You might see micrograms per kilogram or micrograms per liter, and you get the results back. You're like, oh my gosh, this is really hazardous. Whoa. You show it, no, that's micrograms per liter. So make sure you're comparing apples to apples on that. And then, of course, making sure the lab is certified and also certified for that method. And then, you know, having the proper equipment for those different test methods. And you can actually look in SW 846, which I have the link, and all of these things we're putting on the screen are on the conference website. And you can go to this link for EPA SW 846, and you can look up all the different test methods. And then, of course, the state has a lot of information on their website that you can gain, and I have this information here. So if you go to SW 846, and the links are again here on the screen. You can just look up the different test methods. You can say, okay, well, I want to find a test method for fluoride, and you'll find it. And then if you go into that and drill down into that test method, it will say all the steps that have to be followed by the laboratory when they test that waste. And it's sometimes helpful. Yeah.
Again, there's rules for everything. There's sample preparation methods, sample digestion methods. There's extraction methods for the T-clip and the STLC. There's instrument methods. SW 846 has Chapter 9, the whole sampling guidance on how to sample a waste pile, to sampling a tank, to a drum. It's an invaluable resource.
So I wanted to just, before we jump to our next pop quiz, hopefully you're still awake, I wanted to just make sure I have a couple of handouts I wanted to kind of show you here. Hold on 1 second. And again, like I said, these are all up on the screen. So on the chain of custody, one of the things that you can see on that chain of custody is sometimes things that may happen to the sample. You might see notes, I don't have a pointer, I don't think. Oh, maybe I do. Ah, so down here, you can see some place where you say received on ice, tape seal intact. So if you did put evidence tape on that sample, and for whatever reason, it's not marked here, that might be something to take note of. And then this is another funny story. So back, and this is dating me a bit, but when I used to oversee tank removals, they would pull the tank out, and there was this guy, and he was really good at tank removals, maybe not so good at paperwork, but he would bring his bucket of dry ice, and he would drop it in the tank. And after, you know, he'd already rinsed it out earlier, than the day before or whatever. I'd show up, and he knew to wait to drop the dry ice till I got there. He'd drop the dry ice, and then, you know, he didn't want to buy more ice, so he'd put the dry ice, the last chunk, in the ice chest. And then after we pulled the tank out, then he would take his backhoe and pull up to the excavation, scoop the sample at 2 feet and 6 feet at the fill end, right? Okay, so then he'd take the two samples, he would use gloves for this for this process. He'd seal them all up, drop it in the, and I'd put my evidence tape on, and then he would drop it in the ice chest. And then we would get the results back a week or two later, and then I would look at the results, and then I would show it to my supervisor, and if everything was good, then we would write what we call a clearance letter, saying it doesn't appear there's any further action needed. And that no further action letter is quite significant for a UST tank owner to get. And so I had already, let's see, did I already give him the letter? I don't remember. But anyways, my supervisor looked at my whole packet of that I had done, I thought, a good job, and saw the chain of custody. And on the corner, down in the, like, notes for the lab, it said, sample broken. broken on arrival. So he set it next to the dry ice, and it cracked the glass jar. And I didn't even notice that. So then it was this bit, because he'd already filled in the hole and everything, so then we had to have him go back and drill down, and but he's like, well, Sandy, why did you write the letter? I'm like, oh, okay, well, I missed it. So anyway, so that's an old story, but I don't do so much of that anymore. But it's just an example, a reason to pay close attention to the notes on the chain of custody. All right. So getting back to our discussion, we're going to do a little quiz here. Oh, sorry. Let's see here. From current slide. All right. Okay. More acronyms. We're testing if you were listening to Ernie now. What does ND stand for? All right. Number two. Very good. All right. How about MS? All right. Good. Matrix spike. And now you know what it means. How about MSD? Did you talk about that? Yes, okay. Okay, good. Matrix spike duplicate. All right, how about RPD? All right, very good. They listened to you, Ernie. Good job. Okay. All right, so you're still going, okay, thanks a lot, Sandy, but what do I do with this big stack of lab results? And I'm still a little confused. So let's do a little bit more. We'll do some exercises here and kind of walk through the process. But before we do that, I'm going to show you my favorite guidance document. I've been doing CUPA for 24 years, and this, above all else, is my favorite guidance document. It's a state guidance document. And it's got small writing, I know, but I want to still bring it up here. So what I want to make sure of is before you even decide to take samples, before you even have to do all this work of reviewing this big stack of lab results, do you really need to test the waste? And I'm talking to mostly the Coupa inspectors, but some industry as well. So one of the things you've got to do is first, is it a waste? I mean, I know that sounds like a kind of a no-brainer, but if you can't prove it's a hazardous waste, your samples that you're taking, I'm not sure about that, because if you can't even prove it's a waste, if you have results showing, you know, whatever, it exceeds the TTLC, but it's not a waste, then, you know, that's not going to help you. And from an industry perspective, if a Coupa inspector is telling you to test it and it's not a waste, then that would be a good thing for you to know. And for you to know, you've made that waste determination that it's not a waste. So that's something to keep in mind too. I've also had this happen where I tested something that was a listed waste. So that was a waste of money. It was a process waste from electroplating or something, and the facility was not good, not a good facility. They were very much not complying with anything, not even business plan requirements, and they have this etching process, and we knew it was bad because it was going down the drain, hazardous waste down the drain, so we're trying to collect a sample. All of a sudden, and then I called my guru, John Misla, who's with San Diego County Coupa, who's the hazardous waste guru, and he goes, Sandy, it's a listed waste. You don't need to test it. You just, it's this, electroplating, da-da-da-da, F006 or something, whatever. So I was like, oh, okay, so we don't even need to test it. So, and we weren't, this isn't a hazardous waste understanding class, but I just want to make sure you guys understand, are following what I'm saying, where you may not even need to sample. Okay, so then, and Ernie, jump in if there's
just
any.
Just to follow up on that, you don't necessarily need a concentration, but if you get presence or not presence, like an F-listed code for a spent non-specific source, if you get a hit for something, you can use that as your data.
True, yeah, there's, I'm speaking very broadly. There may be a situation where you would want to test it, but okay. And so we're going to go through this. So this is talking about listed waste. Oh, the other thing too, just getting back to these exclusions, and we're going to talk a little bit about regulatory exclusions. And that's for a whole nother class. But just remembering these exclusions as far as the mixture and derived from rules contained in policy, like if there's a spill that happened historically, you may take a sample of it, but it may not be considered a hazardous waste until it's actually excavated out of the ground. So just kind of keep that in mind and be sure you get more familiar with this if you're going out and taking some samples on the ground that may be historical. If it just happened, it's definitely not going to be an issue. But all right, so going through characteristics. The first one on the list here is ignitability. And so this, I love this guidance document because it tells you right here what is the regulatory threshold. So what is the regulatory threshold? If you test for ignitability, what would be considered hazardous waste? Shout it out. All right, right there. 140 degrees Fahrenheit. So if the flash point is less than that, and it's a waste, then it's a hazardous waste. And you can find out more about the methods and everything, and you have the links and all of that right here. And this is taken right out of Title 22. All right, so then corrosivity. Right here, we have, if it's the pH is less than or equal to 2 or greater than or equal to 12.5, it's corrosive. Now there's also, you'll see in here, well, if it corrodes metal, then that could be considered a hazardous waste too. But as far as laboratory analysis, this is your regulatory thresholds. And there's more information about that. If you look at the paragraph on reactivity, because we're covering the four characteristics of what is a hazardous waste, there is no test method to prove reactivity. So you say, oh, well, how can I test my waste to show it's reactive? Well, you don't want the lab to test your waste to show it's reactive. It's not safe for laboratory personnel. In fact, if you have a sample that's reactive, like Ernie mentioned earlier, and maybe you're testing it for something else, you really need to tell the lab and give them warnings. And they may not even be willing to test that sample because of what's in it, because they don't have the means to handle it. So you have to use other things, and they're listed here. Waste that are unstable, they can cause explosions, release toxic fumes. That's how you don't use lab analysis to prove that. That's more of a physical property. So then the biggest one is toxicity. And the next few slides are gonna go over this, but I just want you to see that it's all, everything we're talking about today is all referenced in this guidance document. So there's TCLIP, and this is where I go look when I have to remember what it stands for. And then TTLC, STLC, WET, it's all here. There are regulatory thresholds for acute oral, acute dermal, acute inhalation. Now, you're saying maybe, oh, well, Sandy, do we ever do tests for, you know, acute dermal? Like, probably not, because Coupa inspectors shouldn't be killing a bunch of rabbits or rats. But, I mean, I guess you could. But, I mean, what you can use this for is when you're reviewing the material safety data sheets for something, say they threw a bunch of containers in a dumpster, and they're all sealed, and, you know, you can look at the MSDSs for those products that are now a waste because they are abandoned in a dumpster. Then you can look up the properties, and if you see toxicity characteristics on the SDS that indicate, say, something, it has an acute inhalation toxicity of less than 10,000, then that's evidence for you to show that that is a hazardous waste, and maybe you didn't need to take a sample to do that. And then acute aquatic toxicity, we're gonna talk a little bit about that later, but there is a test which, if the LC50 is less than 500 milligrams per liter, then that would be killing fish, so that would be considered toxic. The one thing you do need to request when you run this analysis, if you're using this as your, you know, determination, is you need to ask for a definitive test. Otherwise, they're just going to say pass or fail, and it's better to request a definitive bioassay test. All right, so make sure you print out this guidance document or keep it handy in your bookmarks, because I use it. I would say I get calls for, you know, guidance at least 2 to 3 or 4 times per week, and I go to this guidance document often, more than once a week. Okay, so we already talked about the four characteristics, and now we're gonna talk about lab results, mostly related to toxicity. I'm gonna do that first because it's harder and more complicated. All right, so we know about the regulatory thresholds. Now, Ernie, this is how we met, is I was in a class, and he had a question, and then he talked about this chart that he made, and that's also one of the handouts, where he put all of the regulatory thresholds all on one page, and even the exceptions, and all kinds of good information. Maybe you can talk about your chart, Ernie. I can try to show it on the screen real quick.
I took Sandy's class about 4 or 5 years ago, and I was that annoying kid in the back asking too many questions. because of that, Sandy asked me to help, and I had already produced this on my own, just for my own knowledge. She liked it, thought we should introduce it to the class, so It should be correct. Again, that's my brain on a piece of paper. But on the left side, we've got all the non-RCRA waste, California waste criteria. On the right side, we've got all the RCRA federal stuff. And then down below, at the very bottom, there's all the footnotes that Sandy's going to go over. The chromium rule, the barium sulfide exception. There's all these exceptions to the rules, okay? So again, Sandy's going to talk about that, but I try to summarize as best I could everything on one page. Obviously, there's more to it. Like, listed wastes are not all there, but again, that's all.
So a good one to keep in your clipboard. Oh, I see a question back there. Hold on 1 second, please.
The handout is not part of this.
I'm sorry. Wait.
We don't have the handout.
Oh, you know what? They wouldn't allow us to, Ernie actually broke the rules by giving you guys that lab report. But that the rest of the handouts are all uploaded on the conference website. They're trying to be sustainable, since we are environmental, to not make a lot of copies. So I'm sorry. But it is, if you can't find it, if you can't get to it, I've got my cards up here. Just send me an email and I'll send it to you. Real simple. If you don't want to worry about trying to figure out how to download it, you can just send me an email. All right. So we're going to talk. So the regulatory thresholds are all in the law. And then we're going to talk about, well, what's the difference between TTLC, STLC, and TCLIP? What in the world? How do I know what to run? How do I know what to look at? So here they all are written down here, and I've got some notes that I want to make sure I cover with you, and Ernie can pipe in as well. And I also have another handout to show you. So, oh, real quickly before I forget, DTSC, write this down if you're interested, a DTSC waste classification online course. It's a really great online course that you can take. It's all free. Anybody can just do it. And it has a bunch of good information. And I would highly recommend it if you need to do a lot of this type of work. And as a Coupa inspector, it's very good information. So we already talked about TTLC. So that means it's the total concentration. So it's EPA method 60-10 for most metals, and then 74-20 for lead. And really, just in layman's terms, it's just determining the total concentration. So they mix it in a pre-measured amount of acid. They do what's called an acid digestion, and then they use that atomic absorption ICP machine to put the sample in and say, okay, this is the concentration of lead, or this is the concentration of antimony, or whatever what we call the analyte would be, the substance. So that's the totals, total concentration. And there's regulatory thresholds based on TTLC. So if you look, and I'm going to show you some examples in a minute, but if you go to those charts I was telling you, in Ernie's chart that all kind of puts it on one page, you'll see a column that says TTLC. The units for TTLC is usually milligrams per kilogram, because it's the concentration, and just the total concentration. And you just compare your value to that amount and say, okay, if it's above that, then it's a hazardous waste. If it's below that, and we're talking about the sample is a hazardous waste, exhibits hazardous waste characteristics is the way we actually technically need to say it. And then it's real simple, and I'll show you in a minute. So then the next one is the soluble threshold limit concentration. So that's where you take the total, you know, you take the sample and you say, okay, I want to know the STLC for one of the analytes, say lead. So then what they do is they take some of that sample and they mix it in some type of a buffer solution, like a sodium citrate is actually what they use, and then they tumble it over a period of time of 48 hours. And what it's supposed to do is simulate acid rain. So think about something being put into a landfill and then leaching into the earth. That's the big problem with the heavy metals. So that's what they're trying to simulate, is that condition. Is over time, is that going to become, how much of that total concentration is going to be soluble into groundwater. And the STLC is the California test method. And when you say, okay, then what's the wet? Well, guess what? It's the same. STLC and wet, those terms are sort of interchangeable. And you're testing what we call the, Ernie said it earlier, the CAM-17. It's the 17 California metals. California metals, 17 California metals. And then the TCLIP, or Toxicity Characteristic Leaching Procedure, that one is the federal test. And it's not as rigorous as the California, but it's similar. So they use, depending on the alkalinity of the substance, they use either acetic acid or sodium acetate, and it's over 18 hours. But it's the same thing, and you're just checking the solubility of that substance. So if something, when I say it fails for TCLIP, what that means is that it's federally hazardous. That's, so not just is it California, it's federally hazardous. When you have something that fails for STLC, that means it's California hazardous, you may need to run that additional test for TCLIP to see if it would fail for federal characteristics. But there's only seven metals, and well, there's eight, because arsenic technically isn't a metal. So there's eight analytes for TCLIP, there's 17, and we're just talking metals right now. You can give other examples for organics. All right, okay. So some of the times where things get confusing. So I heard, though I'm a supervisor, oh, you don't need to run STLC on a liquid. Sandy, you're doing too many samples. Just run TTLC if you're taking liquid samples. Okay, got to do what they say. So then when we have them, the facility, of course, they want to hire lawyers to dispute the violations. Then they hire consultants that are very good at their job, and they say, no, you should have run STLC because, we think those samples probably did have some solids. So if it's a mixture of solids and liquids, then you've got to run the STLC, and you'll see that in described in the guidance. And so, you know, that was an area where you see me right there falling down the stairs. You know, I had it all figured out, and then, you know, this happened. So just make sure, I mean, there is a way to do it, but you have to be able to demonstrate you have less than 0.5% solids in the sample. And can you see that with your naked eye? You look at the sample, it looks like water, it looks clear, but you have to be able to demonstrate that. And we were able to show that, in the situation I had, we were able to show that the lab did do a filtration step, so the TTLC results should have equaled the STLC, but I think it probably added 30 to 40 hours to our case preparation and dealing with the arguments going back and forth. If I would have just run STLC, then it would have just been simpler. But you don't always want to run STLC because it's expensive. So it's just something to keep in mind. And there is guidance on DTSC's website about that too. Yes, thank you, Ernie.
If it is pretty reputable lab, they will run the filtration step. They have to. So again, don't take it for granted, but you can feel somewhat secure.
Thank goodness our lab had it written in their procedures that they did that filtration step when they ran our samples. So we were able to show that. All right, so getting back to the requirements and the regulatory thresholds, when you look at Title 22, so hazardous waste regulations, and I'll give you a section number. Are you ready? Okay. 66261.24. In that section, you're going to find some tables. There's three tables. There's table 2 and table 3. That is the California regulatory thresholds, the STLC and TTLC values, the regulatory thresholds. In a little bit, I'm going to talk about table 1, which is the federal thresholds, the TCLIP thresholds. And you can look them up. And Ernie's cool chart has them all on one page. So table 2 is inorganic, which most of the time for our CUPA inspectors, we're dealing with inorganics, but not always. It could come up with organics too. And our waste generator industry folks, maybe you're doing waste determination on organic waste possibly. I'm going to talk about the footnotes, because see me falling down the stairs there again? The footnotes are where we get tripped up, because there's exclusions. You have it all figured out, and then you look at the fine print, you're like, oh, it contains barium sulfate. It doesn't count if it contains barium sulfate. Oh, okay, I did a sample of a bunch of paint poured on the ground, and I got a sample that shows a bunch of barium in this sample. So it's not a hazardous waste? Well, no, it says right here, my paint has barium sulfate in it, so it's not soluble. I mean, there may be other violations that apply, but just knowing what you're looking at is really important. And the reason barium sulfate has a footnote is because barium sulfate is very insoluble. So there was lots of studies done that, you know, it's like a clay. It's meant to keep paint on the wall or whatever it may be. So it's not going to be soluble. Otherwise, all the paint would wash off the buildings, you know. Or, you know, I'm giving a kind of a strange example. But so there's reasons why they have those exclusions. All right. Okay, so we're going to practice here. I don't know what happened to the top. Is there something? Oh, there it is. Okay, good. Okay, so we're going to practice. We're going to do an example here. So I've got some lab results. We're going to analyze for TTLC. And if you're a generator, if you're an industry person, pretend that you took a sample of your own waste because you weren't sure exactly what it was. If you're a CUPA inspector, pretend you found something in a dumpster or some process where they said, well, I don't know what it is. We've always thrown that in the trash. You decide, okay, you know what? I think I need to take a sample. Because they don't know, and I think it does have metals in it, or whatever it may be. All right, so we're going to check first for TTLC, because that's the best place to start from, especially if you don't know exactly what you're dealing with. So here's our results. They used method 6. Oh, there I am. See, I'm happy. Okay. So for vanadium, they used method 6010. We'd already talked about that, so that's the totals concentration. And our results over here for what's the result for vanadium? Non-detect, all right. Ernie already talked about that earlier. And then what about the results for zinc? 110,000 milligram. Oh, and our units are milligrams per kilogram. And we checked all that on our lab report. We listened to Ernie and Sandy. We were saying, okay. We checked everything. The chain of custody looks good. We're good. So then you pull out the regulatory threshold chart, and I've got it kind of blown up here. So the right over here, vanadium, the regulatory threshold is 2,400. And for zinc, it's 5,000 milligrams per kilogram. So what does that tell you? It's hazardous for zinc. That sample exhibits toxicity for zinc. All right, you're done. Okay. Uh-oh. Oops, this happened to me. Exclusion, dispute, violation dispute. No, this isn't hazardous. We know what our waste is. It's been going to the landfill for years. I wasn't here that day that you did the CUPA inspection. You should have made an appointment for that inspection, because if I would have been there, you would have been able to see, and I could have explained the whole process to you. We've been throwing that in the trash for years, and yes, we can do that because the landfill's okay with it, the place we take it to. And here's the section in the law that says, a waste that would be classified as hazardous solely because it exceeds TTLC shall be excluded from the classification of a hazardous waste as long as it's going to a landfill that's okay with accepting it. Okay, I guess we'll have to rescind that violation. Or we're like, well, okay, we still think that could be an issue. If you think it could be. So what you could do is run the STLC as well if you want to try to show that maybe it is hazardous. Because if it exceeds the STLC, it has to be only exceeds the TTLC. Oops, sorry. It only exceeds the TTLC. If it exceeds the STLC, this exclusion would not apply. So in this case, if you knew more about what you were dealing with, you might say, oh, you know what, we're just going to run the STLC on this sample. But, you know, you have to know more about what, and sometimes we don't. So I don't know that I could have foresaw that mistake that I made. But I learned a lot from it. So if it's less than the TTLC but more than the STLC, have you guys ever noticed that sometimes when you get lab results back, some of the results are bolded? So that's your lab giving you some guidance and using this 10 times rule of thumb. So when they do that waste extraction test that we talked about earlier, for the STLC, they use a 10 times dilution. For the TCLIP, it's a 20 times dilution. So then you can take that, and this is why we had to take math when we went to college. You always still have to use math as you go forward in your career, no matter what you do. And so you have to use that 10 times rule of thumb, and maybe you can figure out, oh, I don't need to run the STLC. It costs extra money because I know that it's not going to exceed the STLC. There's no physical way that it can. So if that just confused you, I'm going to try to give you an example now here. Okay, so, and this is very small, but so here we got the results. So right here, the sample results, and the method again is 60-10. So then, let me get my chart from Ernie. All right, so then you see some bolded results here, and I'm just going to do a couple of the examples. So one of them here is copper. The copper here is 1800. All right. So then our regulatory threshold for copper, I don't know if you, can anybody see it? The regulatory threshold for copper? All right, so it's 250 for STLC and it's 2500 for TTLC, right? So, or I'm sorry, 25 for STLC, 2500 for TTLC. So 1800, is that below 2500? Yes. All right, so you know it doesn't fail for TTLC, right? Okay. So then now you take the STLC value and you add a zero. And you get this false figure of 250. So is 1800 more than 250? Yes. So then you go, okay, we probably should run the STLC for copper. Depending on the situation, you might want to do a little bit more analysis on your waste. All right. Everybody's got that? Okay. Question?
Yes. Going back to the exemption about the landfill being okay with taking the waste.
Yes.
As a regulator, would you make them provide you with documentation to prove that it's okay, or call the landfill?
I would call the landfill.
Yeah,
definitely. Yeah, and you do. There is a burden on the generator for demonstrating compliance with this. So yeah, I might ask them to provide, because they should have evidence that they've noted. And in this case, they did, because it's just that we did. You know, we do unannounced inspections. So the person I dealt with said, "Well, I don't know. We've been throwing it away for years." But the environmental compliance person knew all about this, so yeah, good question. All right. Okay, so then we decide to run the STLC. And we run it on copper and zinc only, because we don't want to run all 17. Does anybody know how much it would cost to run all 17 metals for STLC? Anybody? Who's the consultants? Can you tell me? Can you shout out how much it would cost? No, you don't know. I as far as I know, it's when we run STLC, it's like more than $200 just for one analyte. It's expensive. Now maybe they charge the county more, I don't know. But it's a lot to run it just for one individual metal. And if you ask for all of them, it does add to the cost considerably. And think about that as far as you as a Coupa inspector. And here's another example where I made a mistake. I told the facility, okay, you just have to run TTLC. You don't have to do anything else. Then the results came back, exceeded the 10 times rule. I show it to my supervisor. Oh, they're going to have to run STLC. So I had to go back to the generator and say, oh, you have to run another test. They were very mad. Then once it did come back hazardous, so of course now they have to start paying to have their waste hauled away. And then their waste hauler said, oh, we need T-clip because it's going to a whatever TSDF and they want T-clip. And he called me. He was very mad at me because I told him, oh, you just have to. So don't tell him, oh, you just have to take one sample. Don't ever do that. Yes. Oh, one sec.
Now, did the landfill get in trouble for this? Because now they don't have a proper profile of the waste that they've been receiving. Was this a...
I'm giving you an example just to show you, but in the case I had, it did not fail for STLC. So thank you for asking. But yeah, no, it did not fail for STLC. And the facility actually had done that additional analysis and run STLC, and it was non-detect. So that's why the landfill was okay with accepting it. Thank you for clarifying that. Yes?
Just to add on that, definitely notify the landfill when you are getting documentation. I've had that happen to me. Most landfills are pretty good. They're doing their own due diligence, their own testing. But sometimes I've had people send debris to like construction-only landfills or just different types of landfills. I don't know all the terminology. But when I told them, they had no clue, and they had to backtrack. They had to dig all that stuff out. They canceled, you know, they charged them for the disposal. It was a mess. Yeah. So definitely notify them for sure. Yeah.
And this is just one example, you know, that I had. But there's all kinds of regulatory exclusions out there. That's just one example. So just be aware of that and know more. Ask questions because it can come back to bite you later, especially when you do an enforcement case and they dispute that. And it's good to know, get as much information as you can. Don't assume. All right. So now T-clip, we're going to do a little practice exercise for T-clip. Remember I said it's in table one, the federal regulatory thresholds. So we'll do a little example for T-clip. So here's our sample results. And let's see, I think I have these circled here. Our result for chromium was non-detect. So we say, okay, it's not, didn't fail for T-clip. And make sure our unit, check the units, make sure you're looking at the right thing. It also helps, sometimes they'll actually say the method right in the lab report that it's an STLC or T-clip. You'll wanna look for those kinds of clues to make sure you're comparing to the right table. All right, so then here's your limits right here for, that's your regulatory thresholds. So this is table one. And like I was saying earlier, for the T-clip, you can take the totals and do the 20 times rule to see, if you look at the totals, you can use the 20 times rule to decide if you need to run the T-clip. And there is federal guidance that says you can do that on paper. That's okay. For making a waste determination. All right, so then TCLIP comes into this conversation where we're talking about the footnotes, and this is just one example of one of the footnotes. And I'll have Ernie kind of explain a little bit about chromium, so I don't know if now is a good time or you want to jump in later. But there is a footnote in Table 2. There's actually four or five or something. And so chromium is one of them. And so what it's, so when you're looking at the regulatory thresholds under Table 2, for chromium, you'll see a little 5, and then you'll see a 560. It's kind of different from all the rest. So there's just one number in the column. It's really simple. Like we saw earlier, you know, 25 for copper. Okay, if it's over 25, we know it's STLC, fails for STLC. But for chromium, there's two numbers. There's a 5 and then a 560 in parentheses. And that always confuses me. So I wanted to try to figure that out, and I thought it would help for an example, is to remember in the footnote, you need to know what the TCLIP is to determine what value to compare it to know if that waste is hazardous. So this is right out of Title 22. If the soluble chromium TCLIP result is less than 5 milligrams per liter, and the soluble chromium STLC result equals or exceeds 560, so it's less than 5 for TCLIP, but it's more than 560 for STLC, then it's a California-only hazardous waste. It's not a federal hazardous waste. So non-RCRA means not federal. It's just California-only. Then the second part of that footnote is if the TCLIP for chromium is less than 5 and the STLC is less than 560, then the sample isn't hazardous for chromium. So when you get results for chromium, you really need to know more about the source. Question. And maybe you can comment, Ernie. I'll jump.
Okay. Is this for total chromium or specifically broken down such as hex 6 and the other types?
Okay, so great question. That's the reason why there are two numbers. The feds check, well, they're mainly concerned about chrome 6, but those numbers are total. So with California, if you only have chrome 3, they don't want to say that it's not hazardous. So they added a second value, 560, for anything other than chrome 6. But when you're measuring totals, it's hard to differentiate between the two. So they make you rule out first using TCLIP, and then they make you test again for STLC, unless it's less than 5 or 0.5% solids, and then you can use your total results as your STLC results. So yes, good question.
So we'll just do a quick little exercise that is a little bit confusing, but if you can follow along, I think it helps you sort of with the whole interpreting lab result concept with regards to metals. All right. So here's our example, and here's our, now, oh, first, write down on a piece of paper right now, because you don't have the handout, sorry. So the TTLC regulatory threshold for chromium total is 2,500 milligrams per kilogram. So write that down, 2,500 milligrams per kilogram. And then I already told you, for STLC, it's got a 5 and then a 560 milligrams per liter for the regulatory threshold. So you got that on your piece of paper right now. All right, so here's our results. We're just gonna look at chromium. The result, milligrams per kilogram. This is totals analysis. The result is 110. Does it exceed the TTLC? What is it again? What's the TTLC, the regulatory threshold? I just had you write it down. 2,500, okay, I just wanna make sure on the same page here. All right, so it's less than 2,500, right? 110 is way less. All right. Okay, so then we're going to, and it's right there on the screen too. Okay, so now we're gonna see, do we need to run TCLIP? Because we know about this whole 5 and 560 thing, we need to know about the TCLIP. So let's do a little bit of math and decide, well, do we even need to run TCLIP? Let's just do the 20 time rule. and, oh gosh, 5.5. So the math is borderline. It's saying 5.5. So because of that, we do want to run the T-clip. So we take the T-clip for the sample, and I think, oh yeah, right here. T-clip for chromium, non-detect. Okay, so we're good on T-clip. It's less than, according to that, it's less than. So that means the sample is not a RCRA waste. Now, after you've done that, do you need to run STLC? No, definitely not. And if you're wondering why, I'll run through the steps, but this is going back to the beginning where we did the 10 times rule. So now we know we got the two figures, the 5 and the 560. Because we know it doesn't fail for T-clip, we can use the 560. So 110 is way less than 560. So the totals is below the STLC regulatory threshold. So this sample would not be toxic for chromium, according to this little exercise. So, and if you got confused on that and you want to walk through it again, you can always call me or come back to class later. Because we got to get going, so get you guys out of here. And we're happy, see? That was good. All right, so we're going to kind of fly through these, the rest of the characteristics, except for reactivity, I already mentioned. These are real simple. That it's well, aquatic toxicity's pretty simple. The only thing I can say for aquatic toxicity, when you run a sample for aquatic toxicity, I have to say that a lot of times we use aquatic toxicity if we have no idea what we're dealing with, but we got to be a little careful with that because sometimes a passing result will be misinterpreted. So just because it doesn't kill fish and says, oh, pass, my waste is not hazardous. Well, okay, there's a lot you need to know about aquatic toxicity tests. What does it really mean? What does a pass result really mean? It might not kill the fish, but the fish aren't swimming very straight, okay? So that's still a problem. It's only for fast-acting chemicals. So if you have something that maybe over time it might kill the fish, but it doesn't kill them right away, that's still not good. So that's something to keep in mind. The other thing I don't like about it is that, like I said earlier, a passing result, that it makes them think, okay, everything's fine, but it may not be. And it could affect your enforcement case because you run it for aquatic, you're like, well, I don't know what to run it for, so I'm just going to run it for aquatic toxicity. Oh, it says pass. Oh, okay, this isn't going to help my enforcement case. So just keep that in mind. Do you really want to run that test? It is an advantage, especially with like maybe bleach and cleaners, ammonia, things like that. It is a less expensive, of course, than doing an oral rat test or something like that. And it does have quantifiable results, but you have to ask for the definitive test. That's important. Okay. And it is expensive, so keep that in mind too. So reactivity, there are no tests for reactivity. Keep that in mind. If it blows up, it's reactive. Okay? Or melt something, or fumes, etc. Flashpoint, it's very simple. It's not hard at all. The only thing to keep in mind is when you look at the regulatory guidance and the thresholds, it's for liquids. So if you're running something that's a solid and you're trying to support your case with sample results for what you say is an ignitable solid, that could be disputable because it clearly indicates that this test method is supposed to be for liquids. So, and then the other place where I've gotten tripped up before is you need to make sure your units on your lab results match. Make sure you're not comparing Celsius to Fahrenheit, okay? Make sure you're comparing apples to apples on that. Oh. Okay, pH. Also pretty simple. The big thing with pH, and they may have covered this in other classes, Ernie mentioned it earlier, is the preservation or holding time for samples for corrosivity. If you look at the preservation guide, it says the sample needs to be tested immediately. Well, you can't have that happen unless you have a mobile lab on site, I guess. So just keep that in mind, especially from a generator's perspective. If you're trying to prove your waste is not hazardous for corrosivity, and you have, like, the sample got delivered 2 days later to your lab, and you're saying, okay, my waste isn't hazardous, but you didn't test, you don't have those results immediate, then that could be questionable. From a CUPA perspective, if it's a pH of 0 4 days later, I think it was a pH of 0 when you took the sample. So for proving that it is hazardous, it's, you know, the results are usually, you know what I'm saying. Okay, so again, we do give guidance as CUPA inspectors. It's our job. That's what we all do. I think every CUPA inspector I've ever talked to, we want to help the businesses comply. We need to be careful, though, because we're not their consultant. So there's a fine art to providing guidance without telling them exactly what to do. That's why I love this guidance document. But this can be difficult for some people. And so that's how we can sort of help them understand, guide them through the process. Do not write in your report, sample is not hazardous. Don't do it. I've done it many years ago. Probably the Riverside County people found one of my reports where I said that. But that was a long time ago. I learned since then. That's not the CUPA inspector's job. We don't even have the authority to tell somebody your sample isn't hazardous. So make sure that, and as a generator, remember, it's your job to know. I know you don't know this, you guys do, but there are a lot of facilities that don't understand all this, but it is their responsibility as the generator. Ernie's gonna talk about things you can do to prevent lab errors, and, from there, okay.
So again, summarizing what we've learned today and then putting that forward on a piece of paper for the laboratory, again, complaints that I've gotten, complaints that I've given, definitely, again, I mentioned calibration curves, okay? They're set up for a certain range, so tell them if it's high, okay? Really tell them if it's high. If you give them a concentrated sample, you don't tell them, and they put it in their instrument, you're gonna clog up their machine, and they're gonna get pretty pissed off, okay? So let them know, definitely let them know. See, inadequate sample volume, again, on the CUPA website, sorry we didn't provide it, but you do have that preservative guide. If you're checking for TTLC and STLC and T-clip, you're gonna need a lot of sample volume. So don't just give them a little jar and say, here, I want T-clip, STLC. Again, ensure that you know you've got the proper volumes to give to them, okay? Let's see, vague analytical request. It's the generator's responsibility to run the determination, but like Sandy was saying, that fine line, if we are giving a request, we should know what we're talking about, okay? So tell them specifically what you need done, which method to use. Again, Sandy talked about using the correct methods. Again, labs don't know. If you send them a water sample, they might run wastewater method on it. No, I want hazardous waste testing done on it. So again, really tell them exactly what it is, what you need done, who you are, all that type of stuff. Be as specific as possible. Improper packaging, Sandy gave the UST example. Obviously, package it properly next to the CO2 and it broke the glass. I'm not sure how many people ship samples. I know I used to ship samples when I worked for the federal EPA. Now I take the sample and I drive it right to the lab. So we should be okay on that. Errors on chain of custody, we went over that again. It's really good to label your samples. Obviously have a numbering system if you're taking more than one sample. And then in your notes, write where that sample came from, because as soon as you get the lab back, the lab has some laboratory number on it that you're not going to be able to correlate back in the office once you've got the results. So really document the heck out of how many samples, where it was taken, establish some type of numbering system so that when you get it back from the lab, you know exactly which one to compare it to. And then inappropriate preservation. There's a difference between hazardous waste samples and environmental samples. So a lot of the preservatives for metals would be to add an acid. Again, because if I'm cleaning up a site, I've got this small volume or small concentration of metals. I want to preserve that with some acid so that when it gets to the lab, they can still see it. But what if I read that chart, I got to put an acid, but I'm also checking for acid. I just screwed up the sample by adding my own acid. So there's a difference between environmental and hazardous waste samples. So that summary chart is great, but realize this was made for environmental samples. So something with a smaller concentration, drinking water, soil, it might not always apply to hazardous waste. Okay, because for the first bullet point, we're dealing with really ugly concentrated stuff. Okay.
All right, thanks, Ernie. So I was just kind of wrapping up here. Know the matrix, know the test methods, know what you're asking for. Make sure you're comparing apples to apples. I already talked about waste generator determination. And really being clear in your communication to the facility. It's really important that they understand. If you don't give them clear, failure to make a waste determination. I mean, they might be so scared to call you because they're afraid you're going to give them a fine or something. And they might call the lab and say, okay, I need to test this. Okay, let's see. What do you want to test it for? And, run down the chart and charge them a bunch of money for a bunch of tests they really don't need to do. So give them some guidance and help of exactly what you're looking for as far as the characteristics of toxicity. If it's a petroleum or, some kind of a waste that's oily soil or metals or something like that, you don't need to run pH. I mean, you're not even concerned about corrosivity. They don't even have any kind of corrosive liquids in their whole facility. So why would you tell them, if they say, well, what test should I run? You could at least say, well, here's this chart. Corrosivity means that you have like some kind of an acid waste or a waste that's corrosive. I don't think your waste is corrosive. I think you can figure that out. And you give them guidance so they know what that means. And once you explain it to the facility, they'll go, oh, yeah, no, we don't have any acids. This is just bead blast waste or whatever. So giving them some guidance is really, really going to go a long way. And then hazardous waste generators, making assumptions. You think, I've been dealing with this stuff for 20 years. Nobody ever said anything. It must not be hazardous. It's really important to know exactly what you're throwing away and what you're putting down the drain. And you can always call if you have any questions. Ernie's a great resource, and you can always call me too or send me an email. I'm not the expert on the state. There are experts at DTSC, but I'm very willing to take your calls, and if I don't know the answer, I'll tell you who to call. And that's it. Any questions? Or you can come up. I know it's late.
Thanks, guys.
Okay.